Hello, Malty, Mulling, Malt Manifestations, and thank you to Matt Hart for that malt mention. Welcome to the Bothy, because you're a malt mate. So the Bothy makes you very welcome. I'm Ralfy, your host. This is Ralfy Review 869, and it's a whisky review, because that's what I do here in the Bothy. I review whiskies and other quality spirits, and in this particular occasion, I have a bottle of Bunnahabhain, but it's not an official bottling. It is from an independent bottler, because this series, a short series of Ralfy reviews at the moment, are about specifically independent bottlers, and the extras which accompany these are also relating to making your selection and finding your way through this minefield of what independent bottlers offer. Now, it's true to say that no spirits genre has as many independent bottling options as Scotch whisky. It is far, far way ahead of anything you find from other spirits around the world. Although occasionally, well, when we're now seeing some Irish whisky independent bottlers pop up, but they're still very thin in the ground when it comes to American bourbon, unfortunately, and this restricts the diversity of experience available to bourbon drinkers. So it actually does collectively an industry good, a particular category of spirits. It does good to have smaller companies who provide the diversity of the experience, because in doing so, literally, they provide more choice to the customers, and in doing so, the customers develop more awareness, more knowledge, more loyalty, and spend more money in the products. Simple equation, and it works. Now, I have here an independent bottling from Gordon and MacPhail of 11-year-old Bunnahabhain, bottled at 43%. It's from their Discovery range. And if you're going out and about looking for independent bottlers, one of the first you will trip over, either in a specialist whiskey shop, perhaps in an airport shop, perhaps in a bar, is Gordon and MacPhail, because in fact they are recognised as Scotland's largest independent bottlers in terms of the range and diversity of what they bottle. It's worth noting that Gordon and MacPhail bottle under different versions. So the Discovery version is just a slightly stronger than average than you would expect from many proprietary brand official bottlings. At 43%, if you're in the United States, it's the normal strength. So what they're doing is focusing on small batch, lower strength, more accessibly priced specimen single malts to provide accessible diversity of experience. And I'm looking on this, and I'm looking for the natural colour thing, but frankly, I'm not seeing it. And in my opinion, this is chill filtered. So it really is an independent bottling done in the style of an old school proprietary brand, which isn't such a great start for me anyway, but I've got to bear in mind that you're not as spoiled for choice and diversity as I am, because you could, for example, be in Canada, where there are very few independent bottlings for sale, but any that are, they'll usually be something like Gordon and MacPhail, who have the reach and who have the infrastructure for exporting, because they've got their imports and distributors and all the rest of it as part of the long line of provision. So I've poured a wee glass, and I'm just going to let it settle for a minute and talk about Bunnahabhain in independent bottlings. It crops up quite frequently, and recently the distillers have put out into the secondary market to wholesalers and selling to independent bottlers directly, heavily peated Bunnahabhain. And I have to say, I've been really quite impressed with it, because we're so used to relatively unpeated and non-peated Bunnahabhains that it becomes a bit of a challenge to our senses when we encounter these alternative versions, and it can be quite hard to pin them down. They disrupt the expected experience. But many people who have got used to it, particularly at a younger age, are really enjoying these independent bottlings of younger age stated, heavily peated Bunnahabhain for a very simple reason. The phenolics are more intact, particularly if the whiskey has been matured in a second or even a third fill cask, a lightly active cask. Not like a first fill cask, which imposes a lot of previous content, whether bourbon, sherry, port, or whatever, onto the cask. I mean, there's so many options these days. White wine, red wine, masala. It used to be in the old days that the experts could pick out single malts, but such is the diversity of casks used and versions of single malts now, that process is a lot harder. A classic example of that is Binnriach, which has quite a distinctive style, but it's very different when it's peated, very different when it's triple distilled, and very different depending on the cask influence. It's the same with Bunnahabhain. It's a bit like Kalela. It's seen a lot, but within that name, there's 101 different flavours. So be aware of that. I'm going to have a smell of this. I was saying going to smish. It's a smell taste, a smell fishing. Right, I'm going to have a smell of this. Aromatic, soft. At 43%, I'm going to add very little water. I'll taste it neat first, because honestly, it's one of these malts that you don't actually have to add any water to at all to enjoy it. It is a classic Bunnahabhain signature. Ripe malt notes, a little bit of banana, fresh, slightly maritime, some oranges and soft ginger in the background. It reminds me actually of Bunnahabhain's, which I came across in the 1990s when they were in the Westering Home green bottle, bottled at 40%, because this isn't much stronger than that. But this is a little bit fresher and crisper and more aromatic. It's not as languid as these old school Bunnahabhains. It's very much a modern version, and not any the worse for it, I might add. Taste. Good brisk arrival. Barley sugar and biscuits. Sweet and a soft sour, but a relatively sweet whiskey. It's actually neat. Quite an evocative and splendid version of Bunnahabhain. In its own right, it's a good whiskey. But I'm going to add just a tiny drop of water. Not much, I might add. No. One drop, I'll add another. Two drops, three drops. There's three drops are in there. We'll call it quits at that. Just to mention in my extras coming up, 869 extras, I shall be going into more detail about selecting and doing your private detective investigations into what are better quality independent bottlings and what are worse quality ones. Because if you examine closely enough in various sites online, you will see patterns. And these patterns are very, very useful in getting your bearings as to whether a whiskey is worth buying from an independent bottler, and how they differ between independent bottlers in terms of the quality. Sometimes it's not that much, and other times it's considerable. because independent bottlers do things in different ways. They have different cask management policies. Nose and taste. The nose hasn't changed much. It's just slightly more musty, just slightly more reserved. The barley sugar notes and some soft toffee have become a little more prominent, but it hasn't changed that much. Of course, I've not added that much water, really, which explains it. Tangier in the taste. Ooh, a lot more juicy. Even a few drops of water really livens up and kicks in the arrival in particular of this single malt. There's lemon juice coming into the signature now, a little bit of grapefruit along with it. The ginger's a little more assertive and a little more spicy in the development. And the finish has that soft, crisp tannin note that's just become a little more visible. It's very pleasant. And malt mark, because I'm not hanging around here, it'll be a malt mark of, that's got my malt marks. It's a lovely whiskey. Yeah. In its own right, 88 out of 100. Very tasty. But. But. There's something I need to add to this. And here it is here. This is the official bottling of Bunnahabhain. Independent bottling, official bottling. The independent bottling is at 43%. Looks pretty much chill filtered. There may well be caramel colouring added. I believe that Gordon MacPhail do that to some of their malts. And then you've got the official bottle. And it says in the label, natural colour, unchill filtered, small batch distilled, 12 years old, and 46.3%. So in fact, this is turning on its head the idea that independent bottlings are better presented than official bottlings. If official bottlings are bottled in the UK and Europe at 40%, chill filtered and caramel added, then sure, that's a superior version in the independent bottling. But when you have official bottlings presenting as independent bottlers should do, as in full integrity bottling, making full disclosure on the label, the performance of the official bottling outpaces the unofficial bottling. And there's more. This is a year older. That's a year younger. And if you go on to a pick any online whiskey shop, you may find that the younger, weaker independent bottling, and I'm going to quote the price here because this is a London price, is £49.95. So let's call it £50. So that bottling is £50 to buy, and for to be reasonable about it, in exactly the same shop, the official bottling is £45.25. So it is more reasonably priced, and it is of higher strength, and is a year older. It is a year older than the unofficial bottling, the independent bottling. So this begs the question, maltmates, why should I buy the independent bottling when the official bottling is presented to a higher standard? And it's cheaper. Give me a minute here. The answer is, there's absolutely no reason at all. None. When you put these bottles side by side on a shelf, 99 times out of 100, it makes a lot of sense to go for the official bottling, which is 1 year older and bottled to a higher standard. The unofficial bottling, the independent bottling, fine if the official bottling is not available, or if you're a really keen Bunnahabhain collector and your entire whisky collection is all from the one distillery, which happens, for argument's sake, to be Bunnahabhain, and therefore you want to have a bottle anyway, then fair dues. But I'm using this as an illustration to show that don't presume that independent bottlings are going to be better than official bottlings in terms of calibre of presentation. That used to be the case, it isn't always now. If your official bottling is at 40%, the legal minimum, chill filtered, caramel added, then sure, you might want to pay a bit extra for an unofficial bottling, an independent bottling, to get a superior experience of whatever the quality is from the cask they've bottled. Some casks are great, some casks are decent, some casks are not so good. It's not just it's not just independent bottlers that you run the risk of with the lottery of buying your whiskey. It can happen with official bottlings as well. And as time goes on and whiskey gets more expensive everywhere, people are getting less and less tolerant of what I might call, well, what you might call, shoddy goods. See, the dilemma is that in commercial terms, if the alcohol in the bottle is sound ethanol, professionally produced with no methanol in it, properly presented with all the legal details on the label, that's ultimately where the producer's responsibility ends. The actual flavours, the smell and the taste is your experience and nobody else's. But you will find with experience that you become far more finely tuned as to the subtleties of what makes a better whiskey better and a worse whiskey worse. It's all part of the journey. Just letting you know. I'm Ralfy, hope you've enjoyed this. Pop back again for Ralfy Review 869 extras, in which I'll be talking more with more detail, more pointers as regards finding your bearings with independent bottlers. Take care now.